So we'll discuss about environmental sustainability. So as we saw, like there are three major aspects to sustainability studies. Those are environmental, social, and economic. So what is environmental sustainability? Well, we have this general idea, like the things in and around, like ecological balance, the environmental balance, they fall under majorly into environmental sustainability of the overall sustainability studies. So it has this organization, it has like a five major like a points, like how to go about assessing like environmental studies and what are like environmental actually aspects of sustainability. So intergenerational decisions, the first one. So actually, as we have seen in the overall like a broader definition of sustainability, it talks about preserving resources, preserving like a natural like a balance for the generations to come also. That means for the future. So the intergenerational decisions become very important part about taking decisions on the environmental, social, or economic factors, so that the long term consequences and repercussions can be actually avoided. Because as the world is entering into a very different kind of a scenario in the times to come, where it may become very difficult to come back to the normal which was there in the pre industrialized world. The second part, target welfare, not the GDP. Well, it is very important, as we were discussing, like how the humanity should be taken care of, how the society should function, how the equity, cohesion, and the value system actually works. So always development cannot be measured in terms of GDP only, gross domestic product. So economic parameters wise, countries actually have this actually system in place today to measure the development of that country in GDP terms. But GDP is not enough to assess one person's actually well-being and happiness and how well he is able to live his life. So GDP is not actually overall cannot be a overall indicator of the success of any country. So the value measures of economic and social welfare, they carry more value than the GDP only. The third one, avoid excess population. Well, population can cause to the damage to the a human body, and the environment and the overall ecosystem, the overall, it can, it has the potential to actually disturb the ecological balance. So the pollution actually should be taken care of by each and every means. Because whenever we are doing any industrial procedures or manufacturing, or even we are trying to provide some services, for example, aviation. So in turn of doing so, there is a lot of pollution happening in all of the sectors, air, water, earth, soil, light, noises. There are several types of pollution, even radiation, a nuclear reactor are one of the most considered to be one of the very environmentally disastrous ones, because in case of any such eventuality or accident, the catastrophic actually resultants will be very big. We are all aware of the world's first a nuclear disaster took place in the Chernobyl, Russia. And the Chernobyl is a place where it is said that it cannot be habitable for next thousands of years. So that place is so contaminated with the high level of radiation that it is not safe for the humans. So the second actually accident happened in the Fukushima, Japan, where the nuclear reactor got actually burst for some regions. And then in the coming months, there was this tsunami and a lot of rain, and that actually took away some of the parts of that, some of the radioactive material with it in the ocean and in the nearby areas. And it was observed that radioactive material was found till the very farther distances from the place of Fukushima. So nuclear actually reactors have this very hazardous, very high hazardous quotient. Though they are the source of the a very high volume of energy by putting a very little of a material, but the toxicity and the radioactive material and the radioactive quotient and this overall pollution factor is very high with them. So we must take care of each and every types of pollutions which are possible with the manufacturing or any of these allied industries. And the next one says about protect health of the ecosystem. Well, the health of the ecosystem is very important, because if the balance is gone, then there will be a lot of like repercussions, and that will become like a irreversible actually position from the point where the balance of the earth cannot actually come back to its like normal position. And the last one, shift to renewable resources. Well, we have been discussing resources are like a finite, finitely available. They are not infinite. So the supply and supply of these materials for like our consumption is very, very limited. So we must consume them in such a way so that nature gets time to heal itself, gets time to like restore itself, gets time to bring itself to the balance position. So these are the actually major principles around environmental sustainability. We will move ahead from this and we will see some discussions. So a study in Nigeria assists that evergreen and broadleaf trees can reduce temperature to as much as like 12 degrees Celsius. Well, I think it is very evident. We may have noticed whenever we enter to a, like a foresty area or maybe even cantonment areas of our like a major cities in India, okay, or even like a bigger institutions who have like a bigger green campuses, okay, for example, like some universities and some institutions. So we observe actually a significant drop in the like a temperature the moment we enter into those areas. So why is it so? So it is because of the dense vegetation, the dense plantation which is there in those areas. So because of actually that, the temperature, the ambient temperature of that area actually remains a little lower than the main actually the business like parts of the like a business district part of the city. So this actually observation is based out of like a recent observation based out of like a Nigeria. The next one, the green alleys or streets, rain barrels and tree planting are estimated to be 3 to 6 times more effective in managing stormwater per $1,000 invested than conventional methods. Well, we have been knowing the traditional like watersheds and these like a rainwater like a management, it happens through the roots of the trees. So why forests are important, not just for the like vegetation and oxygen, they actually play a very important part in managing water. So whenever the forest or the green areas, they actually receive like a rainwater, they hold actually a large amount of their own that rainwater in their roots, in the top soil. Okay, and that water remains and gets filtered over the time, and it starts like a coming down through like a smaller like streams and in the form of the rivulets. And that is how actually rivers also get born, because from the mountainous regions, from the like a greenery areas, this water actually starts seeping slowly. If there is a, like a barren flat surface, all of that rainwater is going to run off in like a one stream, and then the next time there won't be any water left behind. So that is not good for the actually ecological balance. So this trees actually play a very important role. If we try absorbing or retaining this water through like a conventional means, like a other conventional means like a dams and all that, so that can retain the water, but not in that actually quantity. And plus, the creating dams and like such structures have their own ecological actually impacts on the like a place. So we should avoid as much as possible, and so we should always like increase the number of plantation, the density of plantation vegetation in the like greenery areas. And the next example says Portland invested $8 million in green infrastructure to save $200 million in hard infrastructure costs. Well, that's an example where these softer investments into like nature always pay like a much yield in terms of like the solid hardcore like infrastructure like activities. For example, like if we want to establish like a greener areas, if we want to have like a fresh air to the supply, if we want to have like a continuous and perennial like a water supply for the like cities and urban like settlements, so we must actually go for the like a natural means of managing these resources in place of managing them actually through like a constructed means or a hardcore like a infrastructure generation, because they can do that job, but they will take a lot of like a money plus their repercussions. So, but natural means, they do not have any like a such repercussions. Natural means actually help the nature to regenerate and grow it back. So it helps actually even other species and other living beings to come back to their like normalcy. The next example actually says view of nature have led to 23% fewer sick days among workers and overall improved well-being. Well, this has a lot to do with the psychological actually feelings of the like a humans. We as a like a social being, we as a human being, we always feel elated and we feel free, we feel like a good in an like a natural surrounding where at least we can see, we can observe like some scenic things, we can see other like a human beings like doing their activities and normal chores, and compared to like someone sitting inside a closed actually environment, closed atmosphere, where he cannot, he or she cannot even see outside. So there are always like a such psychological actually impacts of like a such like a workplaces. So it is always like suggested to have to deliver, to give actually as much view as possible for the workers from their offices or from workplaces, so that they can keep themselves like psychologically connected to the outside world. The next example says New York City has reported annual energy savings of about 81% across a period of 10 years by replacing all its street lights with LEDs. Well, of course, it's a proven fact, I think, from everywhere. Recently, I think in the last few, like last one decade, there has been a significant push from the government of India and the state governments also to replace those incandescent bulbs with the LCD or LED based bulbs. So these actually electrical gadgets have been highly subsidized also, and they have been given to like each and every household on the through the like a medium of this rationing on a like a subsidized rate, so that they can replace those power hungry actually lamps with these power saving actually. So it's not just New York, I think it is true for like every place. So and such actually efforts are commendable for the society. The next observation says cars and trucks account for about 40% of all CO2 emissions across the globe. Energy consumption by transportation is expected to double by 2050. So here we can see these traffic based like these transportation based actually these exhaustion and the emissions, they have caused actually a significant actually contribution to the GHG emission, majorly the CO2. And well, so and if you compare like the number of occupants who can travel in a car and number of occupants who can travel in a bus, so obviously there is a stark difference. So why not to save on these like individual like personal vehicles and go for like you know mass vehicles or the public vehicles. According to 2002 study, public transportation produces 95% less carbon monoxide than cars. Well, obviously, the fact I was like stating just right now, the public actually transportation medium, of course, will save on the numbers. Okay, for a set of like around 40 people, one bus would be enough. For a set of like 40 people, we at least need like 10 cars. So if we go by that ratio, the number, the amount of emission which will be exhausted from the like a public medium will considerably be lower. And the last one says trees and vegetation have been found to reduce urban noise by 3 to 5 decibels. Well, it is true for the like a temperature drop as well as for the noise reduction also, because vegetation is one very good source of actually noise absorption. So it works for like absorbing the noise, whether it is for like a traffic from like any some manufacturing or some machining plant, you know, or any like a such a noise producing actually entity. So a dense vegetation helps always for the sound as well as noise reduction. What are the actually major features of this environmental like sustainability? So the capacity to have like this resilience. What is resilience? Resilience is a capacity to come back to the normal position without much of like external intervention. So it is like an inherent quality. It is the inherent actually property between in the system which tries to, you know, uplift that system once it has gone through once it has experienced some catastrophic event or some kind of like damage. So that capacity is known as like resilience. So resilience is there in the nature by default, like for example like rivers. So rivers have their own like a capacity to heal themselves. If there is some like a kind of pollution or some toxic material which is thrown in the river or that water body, whether it is a lake or something, it takes some time and rejuvenates from that. So that is a resilient actually capacity of that thing. Well, the overall like a planet itself, if we see from the like environmental perspective, has some resilience to come back to like a normalcy, to restore its normalcy. But of course, it has some threshold, it has a critical actually a value after which it will become very difficult, and there is some value after which it will become kind of irreversible to go back to the normal one. So we must actually take care of this the biocapacity, or that resilient actually capacity of the ecosystem, so that it enables itself to restore. And then there is the eco management system. So we can manage like an ecosystem in such a way that it sustains for a longer time. Then there are electronic stewardship, energy, sustainable acquisition, sustainable buildings, vehicle and fuel use, waste minimization, pollution prevention, and water conservation. These are the one few of the major activities around environmental sustainability, which play actually a vital role, and they form actually the major component within the environmental sustainability. Like energy, we have been discussing, buildings are the majorly responsible for the consumption of around up to 40% of the total world energy produced. That's a huge amount. It's even more than the industry sector. So if we see, buildings are the single largest consumer of the total energy produced in this world. Okay, so even if there is an improvement of in the fractions, okay, in the scale of this whole world, that the overall volume will be extremely high. So even if there is a saving of a very small a fraction or small percentage, the overall saving will be very high. So we must put our efforts to improve actually this situation. And sustainable acquisition actually talks about sourcing materials in a responsible way. Sourcing for example trees. So why can't there be a crop cycle for harvesting of trees? Well, some countries like Canada and New Zealand, they have already have such systems in place. So they actually have some managed forests from where actually they do annual cycles of afforestation, and they cut those trees for usage and consumption at the cycle of the those trees specifically. And every year, if we plant X area of a land with the trees, so after that n number of years, we will start getting those X area will start producing those number of trees. And there is still no practically completely replaceable alternative material available for a natural wood or timber. So why not to start having actually such procedure to have forest as a cycle of crop. And there is a point of vehicle use and fuel use. So as we saw, vehicles and such things are the single largest emitters of the pollution. So we must actually work to prevent these things. Waste minimization and pollution prevention. So of course, waste as a byproduct of most of these industrial processes these days, there is a huge amount of waste produced. So how this can be minimized? Because nowadays landfills and these things are becoming very common, and it is almost a practical compulsion that all of the waste which is being generated is not able to get recycled or treated properly, and it is landing into the landfills. Okay, and most of the Indian cities, most of the world cities are actually plagued by this situation. Though there are some countries who are doing fairly well, Sweden and some countries, they have actually developed some mechanisms to go for a power generation from the waste, and they are actually running out of waste. So this is really strange, and I think it's worth emulating in the elsewhere. So let's move on to the next slide. Here I have taken it from a Mitsubishi Electric company, which has actually taken up this cause as a inspiration to drive their manufacturing and other things from their factory. And they have given actually declaration where they have set up some guidelines. For example, the first guideline says apply diverse technologies in wide ranging business areas to solve environmental issues. So that means they are looking for some alternative technologies to deal with this situation. The second actually guidelines is challenge to develop business innovations for future generations, so that these innovative ideas, innovative business models can help to sustain themselves still for the future generations also. The third one, publicize and share the values and lifestyles. So the new value systems Well, these lifestyles should be like propagated in such a way which can become a role model for the other like other members of the society, other members of the community. Okay, those are like a which are like a worth mentioning, worth actually emulating. So the key initiatives what this company has taken is the like a climate change measures, resource circulation, live in harmony with the nature, long term activities, innovation, nurturing human resources. Understanding needs, co-create and disseminate new values, live in harmony with the region. So these are the actually key initiatives taken by this company. Let's look at the CO2 emission benchmarks of like a different, like a familiar things which we generally like a come across. So you can see on the x-axis there are some examples given, like air travel, one year of like a normal human life, and 1 year of like an American's like a human life, and the fourth one says about the car emissions caused from like one car in the US, and the last one says about like an AI model. So let's see, on this y-axis you can see CO2 emission footprint. So here like a travel from New York City to San Francisco per passenger, it takes around like it emits around like 2 units, for example, of the CO2 emission. Okay, so CO2 emission of 2 units, if you compare with like a one person's the 1 year of like a CO2 emissions, so that is around 11 units. Okay, and compared to one like a general human being from like an average like a world citizen. Okay, so the one single like American citizen himself or herself emits around 36.2 units, which is more than three times high than a normal like a human being which is a world citizen. So that means the per capita actually CO2 emission of an American, okay, is 3 times the world average. Okay, let's see like a 1 year one lifetime like emission of a one US car is around 126 units, which is very high. And the strange actually entry into this table is this last one, training on an AI model. So training an AI model actually consumes 626.2 units of like this CO2. Compared to all other, this is very high, extremely high. So how this even this kind of like a new technologies and these systems are like a power hungry, are going to have some kind of impact is actually eye opener actually. So we must actually go for analysis based observations only, where we can conclude with the help of the numbers. Otherwise, sometimes most of our assumptions, they sometimes actually prove wrong. So we must actually rely on the calculations and the data. In the next part of this slide, so the data suggest over here the cumulative CO2 emissions between the year of 1751 to 2017. So from fossil fuels and cement, billions of metric tons of CO2, that is actually unit what they have taken over here. So if you see, the rest of the world, okay, emits around like 140, 150 like a metric tons of CO2, and USA emits alone over 400 metric tons of CO2 has actually kind of excreted during this period, during this timeline. And the second comes like the European Union with the 28 countries, and the third one is the China. So China in the recent times has developed very fast and is developing very fast, and is the one of the largest producers of the largest emitters of the CO2 also in the world. If you see the next country, Russia, then Japan, and then comes the India. Those are the one amazing thing about India over here is even if India is one of the big emitters, okay, it emits roughly around like a 50 like a metric tons of like a CO2 it has emitted between this year 1751 to 2017. But CO2 capture which is needed to compensate actually this emission which has happened in these many years, okay, to bring it back to the normal where we can at least go like under the 2 degrees like a global warming like temperature rise. So India for that it doesn't requires any like CO2 capturing in this thing. That means we are not in a very deficit kind of situations, we are in a positive side. So India as a like a single like a country is not doing that bad. I think it's doing fairly, but of course in terms of like emissions we should we also need to control. And here on this slide you can see like what if that current trend of like a rise in the CO2 rise in the emission of the CO2 actually is persists. So the first line, the top line in the red, it suggests the current trend. If the with the rate of this present actually emission, if it continues, so it's going to go like a way above. But there are some corrective measures which have been proposed by like several agencies. Okay, if we take them, so there are chances that this emission may come down. And there is one actually desired like a sustainable development scenario also, which can be called if this emission can be controlled, can be brought back to its like a normal levels, where it can where the nature finds itself able to restore. Okay, and here in this like a slide, you can understand like what are the like the threshold from where, if there is like a way through which we can bring back that CO2 emission levels to the normal, so it can still be considered at safe zone and where nature can restore and restore itself. The second one is like the uncertain zone, where if the emission continues with the same pace, so it can have some like a catastrophic effect. And the third one is the very high risk zone, in if it the CO2 emissions enter into that zone, then the resultant catastrophes could be like a very high, very extremely bad, and that's a very difficult actually to predict what could go wrong. So this phenomena can occur at the global level, and there may be repercussions like to be felt like in most of the countries, most of the places. Okay, so what to do to like minimize the like energy consumption, minimize the consumption of resources, minimize this overall like carbon footprint, is to understand like what are our consumption habits are. So the our consumption habits in the recent times have changed, and a per person actually consumption of like resources has increased like manifold. So as you can see in this pyramid, so the vegetables and vegetation based, actually plant based, fruit and trees based, actually these produce actually gives us like 100 calories if, and then the at the next level, once the animals actually eat and once the cattle actually consume, so there it reaches only 10% of that, and the 90% of that actually gets lost midway. And then the top level, if you see, it reaches by just 1 calorie. That means the further like 90% from the level 2 to 3 actually decreases. So we see there is a actually trend of like a, you know, the loss of energy at the rate of like 90% from one level to the next one. Okay, so in order to actually save actually this overall like energy, okay, we need to come bring our like habits down to the lower actually base of the pyramid, so that we can minimize the actually losses. So with this actually figure, I would like to highlight over here, it is more efficient, environment friendly to eat fruit and consume actually resources from the like a lower trophic, the lower strata of this pyramid. It is quite evident over here with this slide. You can see the common food items are actually listed down over here, and they are arranged in two different orders. The first the pyramid on the left side suggests like the suggested consumption from low to high in terms of like in this pyramid. So the vegetables, fruit, legumes, they come at the bottom of this, and the sweets, red meat, cheese, eggs, white meat, etc., they come at the top of this actually pyramid. Okay, and in terms of like a environmental impact of them, so the first one talks about the energy, the second one talks about the impact. Okay, so this actually we can see this actually pyramid gets inverted. The impact of the topmost item which is there in the food chain has the most of the impact. So red meat and cheese, fish, oil based actually foods have the highest impact on the global actually level. So this suggests like directly that we should actually go for a diet which is like a vegetable based and a fruit based and this kind of like a nature directly which is produced from the nature. And it is I think very clear from this slide over here ki what are the food items which are considered very bad on the environmental impact actually scenario, and which are the food items which are considered good on the environmental impact scenario. Okay, so you can see on the left side all these fruit based vegetables and vegetable based actually diet are good for this actually consumption. So overall, if we see like how this consumption and how this sourcing of material happens from the like a nature. So we take actually raw materials from the nature, we process them, we design, we then go for production or manufacturing or remanufacturing, we go for the distribution, then consumption, then collection, again recycling. So if this cycle actually continues, then the cycle is closed, but we discussed in the earlier actually lecture. So if the cycle actually closed, then there won't be or the very very minimal impact on the environment. But if there is a, like a residual waste coming out of this cycle, then there is a big problem. So how to actually take care of that waste? So this is one of the challenges, and there are several ways actually. Like you may have read about 3 hours, 4, 5 hours, 7 hours. So there are several actually reuse, recycle, and replenishing such like efforts, such like strategies, which we employ to deal with like residual waste which comes out of like any cycle. So we will study more about these hours in the like coming lectures. With this, I would like to close this session. Thank you.